Hello, everyone. It would be wonderful if I could be with you in person, but this pandemic has really changed the way we do things. And as I speak, I'm still in lockdown in England, actually in the house where I grew up. It was very lucky that I happened to be here when Britain locked us down. And I've been here for just over a year now. The silver lining of that is that I've been able to reach far more people, like millions more people in many more countries, than if I'd been doing as I did before, traveling to different countries for about 300 days in a year. However, that's beside the point. Now I'm here and you're in Hungary, and so it seems appropriate if I start off by greeting you with the distance call, the distance greeting of the chimpanzee, which is this is me, this is Jane. Every chimpanzee has his or her own individual voice, so when you hear that sound, you know exactly who is calling, which is very useful for them because they don't travel around in a troop. And sometimes a young one gets accidentally lost, wants to meet up with the mother, gives that call, and then hopefully the mum will respond and the two can meet up again. Anyway, I hope that I'll be able to come to Hungary and we can meet up in person. So I'm now wanting to talk about roots and shoots. And the reason I started Roots and Shoots back in 1991 was because as I was traveling around the world in those days, I was meeting so many young people who had lost hope, and they were either depressed, angry, or mostly just apathetic, not seeming to care. And I asked them, "Why do you feel this way?" And they all said more or less the same, "Well, you've compromised our future, and there's nothing we can do about it." We have a saying, we haven't inherited this planet from our ancestors, we've borrowed it from our children. I'm afraid that's not true. We have not been borrowing your future. We have been, for many, many, many years, stealing your future. And it's not surprising that young people, looking around at what's happening environmentally and socially in the world today, are losing hope. It really isn't surprising. But when they said, "Well, there's nothing we can do about it," that's where I disagreed. And that's why I started this Roots and Shoots program. It actually began in Tanzania, my house in Dar es Salaam, the capital, when 12 high school students from 8 different schools came to talk to me about the things that bothered them. Why wasn't the government, which by the way was very autocratic back then, why wasn't the government prosecuting the illegal dynamite fishing that was destroying the coral reefs? Why wasn't the government doing more to prosecute the poachers who were killing animals, elephants and rhinos in their national parks? Why weren't more people concerned about the plight of street children with no homes? Why didn't people care that stray dogs were having stones thrown at them and had nowhere to go? And so these young people were very, very concerned about these things. So I suggested go back to your 8 schools they came from and find other young people who also care and we'll have a meeting. So we did. And that's when Roots and Shoots was born. And right from the beginning, we decided the main message would be every individual matters, every individual has a role to play, and every individual makes some impact on this planet every single day. So we also decided that because I learned in the rainforest how everything is interconnected in this world, so we decided that each group, and basically Roots and Shoots would act in groups, which would be an after-school club, or a whole class would join, and there actually are now schools that are all Roots and Shoots with the curriculum involving roots and shoots messages in every subject. But back then, it was, you know, the groups would choose three projects. That's the same today. Each group would choose a minimum of three projects. One that would help people. One that would help animals, including domestic animals. And one that would help the environment that we all share. That was how it began back in 1991. So this is our 30th anniversary of Roots and Shoots this year. The projects that the young people choose obviously vary depending on their age, because we now have members in, by the way, in almost 60 countries now. We have members in preschool, not too many, many in kindergarten, first grade, university, everything in between, and even more and more adult groups, like the staff of big corporations are forming groups, but it's basically for youth. We try to bring groups together, usually virtually, sometimes actually face to face, from different countries and different cultures and different religions, because we find that young people are beginning to understand that far more important than the color of our skin, our culture, our religion, the clothes we wear, what we eat, and so on, far more important than all of that is the fact we're all human beings. We all laugh, we all weep, and when we fall and hurt ourselves, our blood is the same. We are one human family. And that is really important in today's world that is so divided by religion, by politics, and so on. So that's how Roots and Shoots began. And today it's in nearly 60 countries, and it's growing. It's growing in Hungary. And I want to show you this map. And it shows roughly where there are most roots and shoots, those are dark green, where there are fewer groups, but maybe programs that are growing, that's lighter green, and then white areas where we haven't yet got groups. But it is growing, and it is in nearly 60 countries. I want to show a short video. It was made some years ago. It's out of date, but it does give some idea of the kind of projects that young people are choosing in Roots and Shoots. And obviously these projects will differ depending on the age of the students, depending on if they're in a rural area or if they're in a city, will vary depending on their economic status, you know, are they wealthy or not? It will depend on the country they're in and so on. But this little video does give some idea of the kinds of projects that are being chosen. So let's watch the video.
Some people think it's far away. Some know it's with them every day. You are the reason we found out. So thank you, star. There are moments that can blow it away on the wind.
Hello.
To some it's a feeling in the heart. And when you're out there on your own, it's the way back home.
In addition to the projects chosen by the young people, and it's so varied. I mean, you know, they have so many great ideas. But in addition to all of that, we do have campaigns which we hope that young people in different countries will join, take part in. For example, how to get use of single-use plastic. How to eliminate the use of palm oil in so many products, because it's the palm oil plantations, the unsustainable ones in Indonesia, Malaysia, growing in Africa and even Latin America, that are destroying old growth forests, because palm oil right now is being used in everything. So young people are fighting to label products that have palm oil in them that is not sustainably sourced. And we also have a campaign, Eat Less Meat. Why? Because today there are billions of animals, billions, in these terribly cruel factory farms, industrial farming. And they're deprived of every kind of behavior that they would show in the wild. And in addition, lots and lots of land is cleared to grow grain to feed them. Lots of fossil fuel is used to take the grain to the animals and then the animals' meat to the table. And in addition, a lot of water is used to change vegetable to animal protein. And in many places, because of the extended droughts, because of climate change, water is getting increasingly scarce. And also because all of these billions of animals, especially cattle, produce methane gas. And that's one of the very virulent greenhouse gases. And it's these greenhouse gases, mostly carbon dioxide, that can be stored in forests and oceans, but released as forests are destroyed and oceans are less able now to store the carbon dioxide. They're kind of supersaturated and the water is becoming acidic. So this methane gas is produced by all these animals and adding to the greenhouse gases, which circle the world, trap the heat of the sun, and are leading to rising temperatures, which are leading to changes in weather patterns, which are harming the environment and us, leading to loss of animal species. We're in the midst of the sixth great extinction of animal and plant species, and this is caused by human activity. Roots and Shoots partners with other youth organizations that share our values. And at this point, I should say, it's not only all those active groups today that are rolling up their sleeves and getting out there and making a difference, but we also have what I call the alumni, those people who've been through the program and take the values with them into adult life. And there are some examples of ex-Roots and Shoots individuals who stood up against powerful corporations, who stood up against government policy. And as I say, they take the Roots and Shoots values with them. I think all of you know the kind of problems we face in the world today. And I should just point out that the pandemic, loss of biodiversity as species become extinct, and climate change all are due to our absolute disrespect of the natural world. And I won't go into that now, but it's so true. And so we need far more people to understand what's at the root cause of some of these massive environmental problems. And the more we create environmental problems, we creating in some countries conditions where people can no longer live in the way they used to live. This is creating all these climate refugees, and they added to the refugees who are fleeing conflict are causing problems in many parts of the world, and they're encountering hate. You know, We, like the chimpanzees, have a dark side, aggressive and cruel. We also have a loving, altruistic side, just like the chimpanzees. And we need to get together and work out how to push for the loving, compassionate, altruistic side and play down the aggressive, brutal, and unkind side. If we think about all this that's going wrong in the world, it's quite easy to lose hope, isn't it? People look at the news, they look at social media, they see videos, and there's so much bad news. And there needs to be, because there is a lot of bad news. But there's also an awful lot of good news, and that doesn't get the coverage. Everywhere I go, I meet amazing people doing amazing things for the good of the planet, for the good of the future. And that's what I'm trying to spread around the world. And, I want to end up talking about hope, because if we lose hope, and particularly if young people lose hope, there is no hope. Because if you don't have hope, why do you bother to do anything? If you don't think what you do is going to make a difference, you might as well just give up, become apathetic. But fortunately, I do have reasons for hope. Even though people continually tell me, Dr. Jane, you've seen so much suffering, you've seen so much habitat destruction, surely you don't really have hope. Well, I do. And let me tell you, the main reason for my hope is you young people. Roots and Shoots and other similar groups. Young people who understand the problems, who we empower to make a difference, who roll up their sleeves and get out there and take action. Young people are changing the world, even as I'm speaking now. In different parts of the world, there are young people with their sleeves rolled up, working really hard to change the world for the better. And then my second reason is this amazing intellect we've been gifted with makes us more different from chimpanzees and other animals than anything else. And we've not always used it wisely. We've developed weapons of mass destruction. We've used it to overfish, to destroy the fish, because we have these huge machines and we've worked out drift net fishing and bottom trawling and things like that. And we've found new ways of killing wild animals to eat them, or so that they no longer come into conflict with humans. We've used our intellect in many bad ways, but we're beginning to come together. The scientists are creating new technologies like solar, wind, tide power, renewable energy, and many other ways in which we can live in greater harmony with the planet. And we as individuals are thinking about our own ecological footprints and ways that we can leave lighter ecological footprints. Many ways, if we think about it, if we think about what we buy, where did it come from? Did it harm the environment in its production? Is it cheap because of child slave labor or people being paid unfair wages? Very often the case. Was it cruel to animals, like all the food from the factory farms and the industrial agriculture that's poisoning the land with chemicals? So we don't need to follow that route. And Roots and Shoots and the human brain is moving towards finding other ways of doing things that will not harm the environment, that will think about future generations. And then there's the resilience of nature, places that we have absolutely destroyed with buildings or cleared for agriculture or what have you. Give them time, maybe some help. Once again, nature will take over. Once again, they will become places that support wildlife, places of beauty, places where we can go and find peace. We're beginning to make our cities green, and that's so important. People feel better, people feel happier. And it also cleans the air and it helps climate change, provides shade. And people, when they feel happier, laugh more. We need to laugh more. We need to be happy. We need to have fun. That's so important, and it's so much part of Roots and Shoots. And then finally, there's what I call the indomitable human spirit, the people who tackle what seems impossible and won't give up. And either they succeed or others follow in their footsteps and eventually find success. I carry with me, I call him my mascot. This is Mr. H. Many of you have seen him. Mr. H was given to me 28 years ago by an extraordinary man, Gary Horn, which is why he's Mr. H. Gary went blind when he was 21, and for some strange reason, he decided he wanted to become a magician. Everybody said, but Gary, you can't be a good magician if you're blind. He said, well, I can try. I'm telling you, children don't recognize that he's blind when he does his tricks. And of course he arranges his props beforehand. But at the end he'll tell them. And then he'll say, you know, something might go wrong in your life because we never know. But if it does, don't give up. There's always a way forward. And he does scuba diving and cross-country skiing and skydiving. And what I find most extraordinary is he's learned to paint. He's done this little book, Blind Artist, by Gary Horn. He gave me Mr. H thinking he was a chimpanzee, and I made him hold the tail. I said, Gary, chimps don't have tails. He said, never mind, take him where you go, and you know him with you in the spirit. And he made a painting for me of Mr. H. Now, he's never seen Mr. H. He's only touched him. But look at the painting that he did. It's really extraordinary. And so this is an amazing example of this indomitable human spirit. Of course we have hope in the future. Of course if we get together now, we can slow down climate change, slow down the loss of biodiversity, and start to heal the harm we've inflicted. And that's what Roots and Shoots is all about. And every single day, I'm absolutely grateful for everything that Roots and Shoots is doing and for the inspiration all the members give to me to help me keep going as I continue to spread this message of hope and a call to action. Thank you. It's not only human beings who have this indomitable spirit, this will to live. In Africa, the Jane Goodall Institute cares for orphan chimps whose mothers have been killed for bushmeat. We have two sanctuaries. The biggest is in the Republic of Congo, Chimpunga, and a chimpanzee named Wunda, which in the local language means close to death, came as a tiny infant, wounded by the bullet that killed her mother. And our wonderful sanctuary manager, Rebecca Atencia, who's a veterinarian, saved her life. Later, when Wunda was about 8 years old, she became desperately sick. And again, Rebecca saved her life. And I just happened to be visiting Chimpunga when Wunda was released onto one of the three islands we'd been given. Because the center where we receive all these orphans, often traumatized orphans, is so full. There's over 150 chimpanzees there. So on these islands, the chimpanzees can be in semi-freedom. And this is the story of Wunda. And let me say, although I say it in the video, remember when you see this, I never saw her before this day. This is a really exciting moment for me. The Jane Goodall Institute's Chimpunga Chimpanzee Rehabilitation Center in the Republic of Congo has for years been caring for infants whose mothers were killed, mostly for the illegal bushmeat trade. Many of them are now fully grown. Recently, we acquired three large forested islands on the beautiful Quiloo River, where we can release many of the chimpanzees from our overcrowded center. In here is Wunda, and she nearly died, but thanks to Rebecca, she came back from the dead. And here she is about to come out into this paradise. She's the 15th chimpanzee to get her freedom here. And we hope ultimately to have about 60 on the island. Today is the first time I've met Wunda. I talked to her on the boat, trying to reassure her. She must have wondered what was happening. None of us could predict exactly what she would do once the cage door opened. It was a very, very touching moment. One of the most amazing things that's ever happened to me. The warmth of her embrace is something I shall never forget. For Wunda and all the other chimpanzees we're working to bring here, Chinzula Island will provide a wonderful forest home where they will be cared for and safe. To end the story, all our females are on birth control. They have implants. We can't afford to have more babies. We're still getting babies coming in from the wild. But three of the females, their implants went wrong and they gave birth. And one of those was Wunda on the island where she's the dominant female. And this infant, who's now 4 years old, was named Hope. Mother and child are doing well.